All right, and for those of you that you feel like things are good, you're in a good place, just keep working. But specifically, I want us to talk about problem number four, and then we're going to look at number seven. We're going to switch gears and then look at like a free response question, which brings everything together. And then that should put us like right around 11 o'clock, maybe 11:05, where we'll take a break, and you guys will come up. You'll take a good 5-minute break, go for a walk, get outside, go to the bathroom, take care of your parts. And we will then come back and you'll get a chance to work on some differential equations with Ms. Cooper. All right, so number four, here we go. Number four, we're doing the sum. We're going from 0 to infinity. We've got 3x to the nth power. We've got 2n factorial. I wanted to pick this one because this one is just different. This is going to push us in a whole lot of different ways. The request here is still find the interval of convergence. So if you're going to start the interval of convergence, the first thing that you want to identify is what would be a good test to use here? Open for some suggestions. What would be a good test to try?
Ratio.
Ratio test, probably. Honestly, and I talked to Cooper about this, the ratio test is always the test that I'm thinking about first when it comes to this, because the end is just a matter of compared to one. Is this less than one or is it bigger than one? I get clear signals. But maybe you want to use the root test if everything is a power of n. We don't have that. As soon as I see the factorial, and maybe this is what happened in your head too, it's like, oh, ratio test is a good one to use. So if I'm going to use the ratio test, I just want to step off to the side. Is it possible that this expression here is equal to 0? Could this fraction ever be equal to 0? I think there is a place where this would be equal to 0. And that place would be? If x equals 0. But if x is not equal to 0, then this is not equal to 0. Where is your center for this polynomial? For this series?
Zero.
The center is going to be 0. We absolutely have convergence at 0. Whatever happens in terms of radius and interval of convergence, as Ms. Cooper said earlier, not only is this the center, it's the center, right? You're going to converge equally to the right and to the left. So if I'm going to use the ratio test, we're going to do the limit as n approaches infinity. I'm going to look at the a sub n plus 1 term divided by the a sub n term. I would expect you guys are really good at this next part. Power everything up. 3x to the n plus 1 power. 2 times n plus 1 factorial times 2n factorial over 3x to the n. And now we're going to look for cancellation, if we have any cancellation. Does anybody see any cancellation? I want to get some answers. Where do we see cancellation at? I see 1. What could cancel? I see 2. I see 3. Yes, ma'am.
The 3x to the n.
The 3x to the n cancels out with the 3x to the n plus 1, leaving behind just 3x. Any other cancellation? Don't see cancellation. There's one more place where there's going to be some cancellation, but we're going to have to be careful. It has to do with the factorial. Stephen, what do you see?
I think you cancel out the 2 within the factorial function.
Okay, and here's the problem. I think part of it is, as collectively, we don't get a lot of practice with the factorial. I would expect students are going to make that mistake. So here's what I would do. Imagine just for a second, like an n value. Let n equal 3. If n's equal to 3, then this is 6 factorial. If n's equal to 3, what do we have over here? This is 8 factorial, which is 8 times 7 times 6 factorial. The 6 factorials would cancel, but the 8 and the 7 would survive. We're okay with that? What if n was something big like 10? Well, then this would be 2 times 10, 20 factorial, and down here, that's 11, what is this, 22 factorial? Which is 22 times 21 times 20 factorial, and the 20 factorial is canceled. Yes, ma'am.
Question. So, like, are we assuming, like, there's a 1 multiplying the factorial, and then you distribute the 2n on the bottom?
Am I assuming?
2n plus 2?
Oh, like, here you're seeing this as 2n plus 2? Absolutely, that works. So 2n plus 2 factorial, is everybody okay with this idea of like testing the cases? What happens, in both times I tested this, what survived are the first two terms and everything else canceled. Well, the first two terms in this 2n plus 2 factorial are 2n plus 2, and then the number just one less than that, and then after that it's the 2n factorial. The 2n factorial would cancel with the 2n factorial, and what you're left with is 2n plus 2 and 2n plus 1. Just those. Okay, we're gonna get limit n approaches infinity. What survived? 3x. In the denominator, 2n plus 2, 2n plus 1. The question that you ask yourself now is, what's the limit as n approaches infinity? What happens as n gets big? Talk to somebody near you. What happens as n approaches infinity? Think about that fraction. So what's going to happen as n gets really big? The fraction gets smaller. It gets closer and closer to zero.
You guys okay with zero?
Okay, so your limit is zero. The significance of the zero, that's your limiting answer. You're supposed to then compare this to one. When is zero less than one? This is always true. So when does my series converge? Right, zero is always less than one, which means that my series that I'm testing with the ratio test always converges, right? So my conclusion here would be then that this series, n goes from 0 to infinity, 2x to the n over, oh wait, I'm writing the wrong one, aren't I? Sorry. 3x to the n over 2n factorial always converges. In terms of your radius of convergence, it's infinity. In terms of your interval of convergence, it's all real numbers. Vivian.
So like when it doesn't have an x on the zero side,
yep,
it's converging?
All the ones that we've done prior to this, we had answers like absolute value of x over 2 is less than 1, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you'd say, oh, there are some times where this expression is going to be less than 1, but it depends on what the x value is. Over here we get 0, which has nothing to do with x. 0 is always going to be less than 1, so we always have convergence.
Okay.
That was the point. All the friends are okay? All right, good. All right, number 7, and then let's have free response. Steve, are we still going?
Yeah.
Oh, thank God. All right, number 7. I want to give you guys just a minute or two. Go as far as you can on your own, and then we'll talk. Watching at home, probably thinking about the ratio test. Good choice here. If I'm going to use the ratio test, I just need to make sure that my terms are not going to be equal to zero. I've got a fraction. And the only way a fraction is equal to zero is if the numerator is equal to zero. Mm-hmm. The only reason the numerator would be equal to zero is if x is equal to zero. So I'd say something like, if x isn't equal to zero, a sub n isn't equal to zero, use ratio test. You really want to make sure you're getting in the habit of showing the test that you're using in the beginning, that you've satisfied the conditions. Is everybody okay with the ratio test? Okay. And the next thing I'm just going to look for, I'm going to say, all right, do you have the setup right? Limit as n approaches infinity, a sub n plus 1 over a sub n. Limit as n approaches infinity, a sub n plus 1 is 2x to the n plus 1 power. N plus 1 squared. To divide by a to the n is the same as to multiply by n squared over 2x to the n. If you get there, another point earned. That'd be good. We look for some cancellation. I want to do this part fast. 2x to the n plus 1 power, 2x to the n power. Hopefully these are the obvious ones. These guys cancel out and you're left with 2x. N squared, n plus 1 squared, these don't cancel. They can't cancel. They don't have a common factor. Limit as n approaches infinity, absolute value of 2x times n squared, n plus 1 squared. Getting here probably earns you another point. It's just going to depend on the scoring rubric. N approaches infinity, 2x doesn't change. So I'm just interested in what happens over here. N squared, n plus 1 squared, I think you guys all know exactly what this limit is. This is going to be 1. So your final answer, your final limit, is going to be the absolute value of 2x. Getting there often gets you another point. We're comparing this to 1. Depending on your algebra skills, depending on how you think about this, you know what the radius of convergence is. How many of you guys are in that place? You're just like, you know what it is. Steven, I see some other folks. Josh? Oscar. Oscar. What's your radius of convergence going to be?
1/2.
Why 1/2? You're going to divide by 2. Right. If you get to the point where the absolute value of x is less than 1/2, then you know that the center is 0 and the radius is 1/2. If that is not comfortable for you, then like when I used to teach algebra 1 and we were doing absolute value inequalities, I'd say translate this into something more comfortable. If the absolute value of 2x is less than 1, that means that 2x is less than 1, but it's greater than negative 1. Divide everything by 2, you get negative 1/2 is less than x is less than 1/2. What you've just established is now you can see, oh, center is 0. My radius is going to be 1/2. Everybody's good at this point? Not done? Not done because endpoints. Have to test the endpoints. Are we still filming, Stephen?
Yep.
Excellent. So you're going to go and you're going to test your endpoints. Okay, first endpoint, x is going to be 1/2. If x is 1/2, your series is 1 to infinity. 2 times 1/2 is 1 to the n over n squared. Well, gosh, isn't that the same as 1 over n squared? Have a quick conversation with somebody near you. What do you know about that series? And how do you know it? What's true about that series? And I've heard it from a bunch of different folks in the room. This is a P series. I love you. It's P series. Yes, this is a P series. Specifically, P is equal to 2, which is greater than 1. So guess what? Converges or diverges? Converges. P series, I always have to stop and think. Is the fact that like P is greater than 1 means converges? I'm so glad I'm not alone in this.
I always think it
about it is it's like 1 over n, which is like an inverse function, right? 1 over n is like 1 over x. So it's the opposite convergence rule of like all the other things. I don't know that that's like an official way to think about it or not, but like for me, that's how I think. Like it's not less than 1, like root and ratio.
Yep.
It's greater than 1 because it's
p-series, p's equal to 2. We have convergence.
Sometimes I make up things.
All right. Now, we've got x equals negative a half, which makes this series 2 times negative a half, negative 1 to the n, over n squared. Hey, good news. Alternating. This one I've got alternating, and the other things to check. For a sub n, which is 1 over n squared, two things that you need to state. If we're going to use the alternating series test, go back to that cover sheet if you need to. The two things that have to be true here. What are those two things?
The limit from a of n has to equal.
Okay, the limit as n approaches infinity of 1 over n squared, is that equal to 0? Pretty obvious. I would assume for you guys that's pretty obvious. The other thing? Oh, there's a second thing.
Decreasing.
Is this a decreasing series? Mm-hmm. Right? N gets bigger, 1 over n squared gets smaller. Decreasing. So I'd say, therefore, this guy here, negative 1 to the n over n squared, converges by the alternating series test. Your interval of convergence, or big I then, I think we've just established, is from negative a half to a half. Yep.
I'm gonna ask you a question. I don't wanna put you on the spot too much. Is there ever a time where a sub n would go to 0, but not be decreasing?
I think the fact that it has to be like monotone decreasing, right? It's only decreasing. There's like no wiggling that's happening along the way. I know that's not like official right word here, but like the fact that the series itself, the sequence of terms, is decreasing and only decreasing in a monotone kind of way, like that's the issue.
Okay.
Now I can't think of a sequence right now off the top of my head that would do that. Come back next year, we'll have that figured out. How are we feeling about radius and interval of convergence? I feel like we've got this in a good place. Good, it is a high scoring, lots of points coming kind of way. All right, so now let's go and look at a free response question. And I will tell you, and Ms. Cooper knows this as well, so if I start lying, she'll hold my feet to the fire. She is not a liar. Just about every single year, I think you would have to go back a very long way. Oh, this is on page 11. Pretty much every single year on the AP VC exam, question number 6, specifically question number 6, is a series question. For those of you that are going to be on Wednesday or Tuesday, you'll be like, hey, we've been studying series for like 3 weeks. Go to number 6 first and get it done. That is okay.
In the calculator inactive part.
In the calculator inactive part, once you reach that part. You know, don't be like, hey, it's the multiple choice part, here we go, that would be bad.
Yeah.
You won't have that test. But if you're like, where's that series question? It is almost always number 6. Almost always, okay? You know, if that's your jam, great. If you're like, man, series has been the worst thing that has ever happened to me, I hope the whole test is polar and parametric. You know, maybe you hold off on that to the end, but pretty much number 6, it's the guaranteed series question.
I think we're opposites on that. Like, I'd rather have a whole test of parametric and polar.
Oh, no. I mean, I love my parametrics and polar, and I can score, like, really high and all that, but that's not as interesting as the series stuff. I just, oh, God.
See, this is why math is so awesome, because you can love different parts of math.
Mm-hmm. All right. It's kind of like, you know, kids. You can love kids differently. Or not at all.
We love you all, just
differently. Differently, or not at all. All right, so this question is, I would say this is fair game. This is what you should expect to see when you, on Tuesday or Wednesday, get to question number 6. This isn't actually question number 6. But this is what you can expect to see. What I want to do is give you guys the first couple minutes to just go as far as you can. Get some help from the other superheroes around you. If you need some more sugar for some stamina, feel free. This is 5 minutes for you to talk and plan and do as best as you can. Careful. I know we've just spent the last hour and a half talking about radius and interval of convergence. And some of you are like, yeah, let's do that. That's not how I'm reading part A here.
In part B, so they probably didn't want to make you have to check conditions twice and make too many points about conditions.
So, Miss Cooper, I don't know if you've had this experience in Southeast, but the other day, it was a laughable experience. The other day, a bunch of kids came in for tutorials, and they were working on series tests. And I looked at it, I was like, oh, you know, I like it, but I don't love it. And they're like, oh, we know that means something's wrong. And somebody was like, oh, you forgot to write the checklist. Positive, yeah, decreasing, and continuous. And they were like, oh, yeah, write it. I'm like, no, it's that you're, like, stopping and you're thinking about it, right? And we're like, just write it, that's all you gotta do. Don't forget to put the little check mark so that they think you thought about it. It's like epic fail.
I would say...
But at least do that.
I would say probably not so much this, but in statistics. That's definitely a thing with all the tests.
Did you consider it?
Yeah, kind of.
I wrote it down. I know these three things are important.
Okay, I was afraid. I did
right. Like this series says this function is converging to one particular number. If this integral converges, then your series is going to reduce. If this approaches infinity, then the series
is
so it's a matter of getting integrate this. What did you try to do?
So, do you know what's the net the root?
for all the folks that are at home and all the folks in the room, let's pull together. Now my timer hasn't gone off yet. Oh. Yeah, that good. All right. So your ace of n's are 1 over n, natural log of n for n greater than or equal to 3. Really, they're asking you about this series over here, 3 to infinity, 1 over n, natural log of n. And they've told you that the function f of x equals 1 over natural log of x is positive, it is decreasing, it is continuous. You put those three things together, and that means we can use the integral test. Now, what I've seen on just about everybody's paper is saying, all right, I'm supposed to do the integral test. So what that means is I'm supposed to actually look at this integral. And the integral test says if that integral converges to some number, then the series converges. If the integral diverges, then the series diverges. And I think a lot of folks are just kind of like stuck here, like how would I ever integrate something like this? Substitution's the key. Specifically though, what's the U? What's the U that makes this work? One person. I've got 1 over x and the natural log of x. And I see it getting whispered to some folks. Steven, what's u going to be?
Ln of x.
If u is the natural log of x and I go and I find the derivative, du dx is 1 over x, which means that I can say du is the same as 1 over x dx if you want to say it that way. When you come over here and you do your integration, instead of 1 over x natural log of x dx, well, the natural log of x is the u, so that's going to be in the denominator. The 1 over x and the dx, is everybody okay that that's going to be du? And hopefully that's easy to integrate. You got to be careful. You need to know your new limits of integration. These used to be x equals 3 and x equals infinity in terms of u. If x is 3, then u, that lower limit is going to be the natural log of 3. If x is infinity, then u is the natural log of infinity, which is infinity. The integral of 1 over u is the natural log of the absolute value of u. We evaluate from natural log of 3 to infinity. We plug in natural log of infinity minus the natural log of the natural log of 3. And the only thing we need to know is this a number or is this infinity? Right? Natural log of infinity, that natural log graph is increasing. This is infinity. Therefore, 1 over x natural log of x dx from 3 to infinity diverges. And from this, we know not that the integral, but we know that 1 over n natural log of n from 3 to infinity diverges. Diverges by, integral test. For all the friends in the room, I'm just curious, how many of you felt like I knew what to do with the integral test, but it was the integrating piece that was maybe the tricky part? Like not, but once we got past that, everything was good? Okay, then we're in a good place. All right, part B. Consider this new series. Now we're going from 2 to infinity, negative 1 to the n, a sub n, and they've given you this sequence of terms. The only piece I care about right now is the first part. Identify properties of the series that guarantee the series converges. Do not worry about this next part. I don't know about Southeast. We have not had any conversation about error at all. And that was like a conscious choice that we're making right now because it is such a teeny tiny little thing.
I mean, we talked about geometric sum. geometric
sum.
When you did
the
geometric
yes.
series, but
when I did integral tests, I deliberately skipped the remainder
yeah.
theorem. We haven't done anything with Lagrange. We haven't done anything with alternating series test remainders. That's Monday. Okay, so take a little bit. Part B. How do you know that this series will converge? What are the things that you know for sure? David, don't worry. You're going to be okay.
What test maybe comes to mind as you're looking at that series in part B? So what properties would we need for the series to converge if we're thinking alternating series? No, you're right. What do we need, Dario?
The limit approaches zero.
The limit of what? The function?
The series.
If a sub n is 1 over natural log of n, right?
1 over n times natural
log
of n.
1 over n times, yeah, sorry.
Yeah.
You want the limit of a sub n as n goes to infinity to go to 0, right? Which I think is what you said, but you were mumbling. It was making you say it louder.
So the limit as n approaches infinity of a sub n is 0. And can everybody just kind of like see that at this point in your calculus career? N gets big, natural log of n gets big, denominator gets big, the whole thing gets close to zero. That's good, that's not enough. There's two more things, two more really important pieces. Dario helped us with the first one. The terms approach zero, but there's two other things. David, did you have something?
The density decreasing.
Are the terms decreasing? Think about it, the n's only get bigger. N gets big, natural log of n gets big, 1 over bigger gets smaller, decreasing. There's one more thing. They're alternating. What drew your attention to this in the first place is that the terms are alternating, but you have to say it. You have to say, I know the terms are alternating, I see that the terms are decreasing, I know that the limit is equal to 0, done. So limit decreasing and alternating, therefore converges by the AST. Now, sad panda, as Miss Blakely would say, all that? 1 point. You didn't actually have to do that much work. You just had to like state the conditions. That was all. But now, good news. Now there's part C. Find the integral of convergence of the power series. Show the analysis that leads to your conclusion. Take a couple minutes. Get as far as you can with this. 5 of the 9 points on this question are on the table available for you right now.
You gotta go wait.
After this, we're gonna take a break.
You're leaving?
See you later. Which campus are you going to now? Okay. Oh, you're actually going somewhere. I was waiting for you to say, like, oh, yes, east end. Yeah. Do the circle tour of Houston.
Bye, April.
Bye,
Dory.
Bye, Tom.
Steven, are we still filming?
Yep.
Dang. Okay. So, Cooper, we might try to film your differential equation session.
Awesome.
Living the life.
Is
shit, we're all looking at scoring. And then I'm like, oh.
I was just curious how they were breaking it down.
I've looked at your answer keys a lot for now that you've asked them, and sometimes I'm like, yep. Just making sure.
Okay, so I'm seeing a lot of good ratio test stuff happening.
All right, so for the friends watching at home, I'm going to try the ratio test limit and approaches infinity, a sub n plus 1. You guys gotta look up just for a second. Get this as the initial ratio? Okay. Picked up the point. Made it to here. They're not actually awarding a point for the simplifying here, and I think part of it is there's not really much simplification that can happen. The point comes in with, can you get the limit of this expression? If you take the limit as n approaches infinity, what's going to happen to this whole expression? X minus 2, nothing. N in the n plus 1, that limit. N over n plus 1. And what's that limit going to be?
1.
1. Right? Degrees are the same. Natural log of n plus 1. These guys are growing at the same rate as well. 1. So the final answer for your limit is absolute value of x minus 2. Getting here gets you the next point. How many of you guys made it to absolute value of x minus 2 as your limit answer? We get some folks making it there. But now be careful. You're comparing this to 1. The thing that you know right now, where's the center? The center is 2, the radius. Radius is 1. If this whole like identification of center and radius from the absolute value doesn't work, maybe you do like a little side work, kind of like we did back in algebra 1. Absolute value of x minus 2 is less than 1. That means that x minus 2 is less than 1, but it's greater than negative 1. At 2 everywhere, 1 is less than x is less than 3. Hey, guess what? If you like put this on a number line, with 2 as your center, you go 1 space to the right, 1 space to the left. We know converges in here. We know diverges here, diverges here. The question is, what happens at 1 and 3? Just have to check your endpoints. So let's test those endpoints.
Are there any points at this for center and radius, like for getting that like initial 1 to 3 interval?
I just checked their scoring rubric, and the answer there is no.
Okay.
That it was 1 point for the initial setup. It was 1 point for getting here. Mm-hmm. The next point is for the consideration of the endpoints.
Okay.
And then there's 1 point for the final answer.
Okay.
So let's look at endpoints. What happens if x is equal to 3? Well, that series becomes, we're summing from, 3 to infinity. And we've got 3 minus 2, which is 1. To the n plus 1 power, 1 over n, natural log of n. Does anybody know what that series does?
Look at part A.
Oh, you cheater. What does that series do?
It diverges. David, how do you know diverges?
Fair enough. She's going to stay quiet for the next part.
I'm sorry.
Is everyone okay? Right? We know this series. It's what we worked with in part A. So you could say diverges, but tell me why it diverges.
Interval 3.
by integral test, or you could say like from part A. Okay, great, you've checked a endpoint. You've got to get the other one now. X equals negative 3. Well, x equals negative 3. Now we're going from
1.
3 to infinity?
No.
1.
X equals 1. My bad.
One.
X equals 1. 1 minus 2 is negative 1 to the n plus 1. N times n natural log of n. What about that series?
Does it convert because of the part B?
You're a good pattern guy. Right, that series is going to converge. We've already worked with this series. This is the alternating series from part B. So I'd say converges, but tell me why.